Manifesting life. Manifesting life. And when I speak about life, I'm not speaking about our Adam life. I'm speaking about the resurrected life. I'm speaking about Zoe, the God kind of life. Manifesting that kind of life. Wherever Jesus went, he manifested the life of God. He manifested everlasting life. When he multiplied the bread and the fish, he was manifesting the life of God. When he opened blind eyes, he was manifesting the life of God. When he raised that little girl from death, he was manifesting the life of Christ that was in him. Every blind eye, every cripple that he healed, every miracle that he performed, he was manifesting the life of God. The word says, for this purpose, the Son of Man was manifested so that he could destroy the works of the devil. That's why Jesus came. He came to destroy the works of the devil, because the life that is in God is to destroy. The purpose of the life of God is to destroy the works of the devil, sin, sickness, and death. That is the purpose of God, to destroy the works of the devil in our lives. In the word we read concerning Jesus, in him, in Jesus, was life. That word life, Zoe. And that life was the light of men. It was the light of men. And that light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it, or the darkness did not comprehend it. Isn't that powerful? In him was life, and that life is the light of men. See, the life of God is light. And wherever the life of God comes, light comes. And where light comes, darkness must go. Darkness cannot remain where the life of God is. Can you say amen here this morning? Where there is light, there is no darkness. And so it happened that Lazarus died. Good friend of Jesus. And the sisters Martha and Mary. He died, he was dead for 4 days, and they called Jesus to come. And the Bible says that he didn't go immediately, but he waited a while. And after 4 days, he went. And Lazarus, his body was already decaying. He was in the grave for 4 days already. And Jesus came. And he called his name by saying, Lazarus, come out. And we all know the story, what happened. And I want to pick it up here. You can read with me here from verse 44. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. And I want to focus on this here. Take off the grave clothes and let him go. At the grave, Jesus said to Mary and Martha, when they were doubting, and they were really blaming Jesus for not being in time. Who knows that God always comes through on number 99? Come on now. Have you experienced that God is never too early? He's never too early. But I want to add to that, he's never too late either. He's always just on time. Amen. Now, you see, for us people, it would appear that he was too late in the case of Lazarus. Because death is final. Death is, you know, closing the curtain. Death is the sun sets. Our life is over. But God is outside of time. He's always, can you say amen? He is always in the now. He's not outside of time. So he can never be too early. He can never be too late. He's always on time. So when he pitched up there 4 days after Lazarus was died, he was on time. And he said to them, to Martha and Mary, I am the resurrection, and the life. And we need to allow that to come into our hearts this morning. I am the resurrection and the life. What Jesus was saying, I am life. I am Zoe. I'm the God kind of life. That life is in me. And that life I can impart to whoever I want to. I can impart that life. That's what I came for. I came to impart my life to you. That everlasting life. Even though somebody has died, yet he will live. Because I am the resurrection and the life. Even though your body died, your spirit is alive. And there is coming a day when I will also resurrect your mortal body. I will come and I'll touch your body. I will call your body out of the grave. And you will live by the life that I've imparted to you. That same life that is in me is also in you. If you believe in Christ. Amen. All over the world, the church is celebrating the resurrection today. All over the world. Millions upon millions upon millions of Christians, like us, are celebrating the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ today. But are the people of the world really impressed by us? Are they really taking notice? I'm asking that question. No, they're not impressed. And they're not really taking notice. They are just carrying on with their normal things. Why? Because they think we are crazy. To them, Jesus is a historical Jesus who died 2,000 years ago. To them, we are a group of people that believe in the resurrection of the dead. And to them, that is foolishness. To them, Christianity is just another religion for people who have got nothing else to do. To the world, that's what they think when they look at us. We proclaim Jesus is alive. Say to somebody next to you, Jesus is alive. We proclaim that. We proclaim He is resurrected. We proclaim He lives inside of us through His Holy Spirit. But for the world, that is fake news instead of good news. Why? We can't blame the world. We really can't blame the world. Come on. Can we blame the world? If they think it's fake news, if we say to them, Jesus is alive, look at us, and you can see Jesus is alive. Well, we have to fake a resurrection like the other day. Somebody was prayed for, and he rose from the dead out of the coffin. Afterwards, they found that it was all faked. When the world looks at the church, honestly, it's difficult for them to believe that Jesus is alive and that He's resurrected and He is in us. It's difficult for the world because, the question is why? I want to say something. Because there is a big difference between celebrating and demonstrating. Amen. Thank you for the amen, yeah. See, we as a church for more than 2,000 years, we've been celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. There's been a lot of celebrating. We come to church every Sunday, we celebrate. And there's been a lot of celebrating, but little demonstrating. But I think it's going to change. Can you say amen? Amen? Why? Jesus said in Mark 16, verse 17, and these signs will accompany those who believe. It sounds to me like demonstrating. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover. Can we believe Jesus? Yes, we can believe Jesus. That's a promise. The Apostle Paul said here in 1 Corinthians, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Come on. See, Jesus was empowered by the Holy Spirit. When he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, after he was baptized in the Jordan River, the word says, and the Spirit of God came down upon him like a dove. And he got empowered by the Spirit of God. And his ministry began on earth. Before that, we never read that he cast out any demon or healed any sick person. But after he was empowered by the Holy Spirit, he went out in the power of the Spirit of God and he began to destroy the works of the devil. Can you say amen? See what the world needs. The world needs a church that can go out and destroy the works of the devil. The world needs a church that can manifest the life of Christ. The world needs a church that can shine its light. Wherever the church goes, there must be the light of Christ. There must be the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on. Jesus said here in Acts 1 verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. I think everybody knows, but just in case somebody does not know, this word power here is the Greek word dunamis. Dunamis. From where we get the word dynamite. Wow. Dynamic power. When we receive the Holy Spirit, we receive dynamic power. In 1993, when I was praying about the church, this house, I was before the Lord. And I was crying out to God, and He gave me a promise. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit. A lot of prophetic word went out over this house in the beginning. Who believes in prophetic word? I do. But I could not see that happen because I looked at myself. And I knew who I were. I knew that it is not possible for a man to do something like that. In other words, the Lord said to me that He's going to do something. I'm just saying this for your sake. He's going to do something in the Vile Triangle. Okay, he's going to do something in the Vile Triangle that will really start a revival, like a wave going. And we've seen it through the years what God has done already. And I believe we are in the beginning phase. There's an awakening taking place already. God is bringing an awakening. Why? Because it's not by might, not by power, but by the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, you will receive power. You'll receive dynamic power from the Holy Spirit. And you will be my witnesses. Witnesses means there will be a demonstration. There will be a revelation. There will be a display of who I am. You will be my witnesses. The Greek word here, martyrios, which means you will be my martyrs. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. It means you are going to be attacked by the enemy. But the Holy Spirit will give you power and strength to overcome the devil. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise offering here. Jesus said to his disciples, you are my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. And it's by the power of the Holy Spirit that the gospel is going out. The church was born to manifest the glory of God on earth. That's the purpose of the church. It's to manifest. Say manifest. What does it mean? It means to reveal. It means to display. It means to demonstrate the glory of God. It means to be a light. It means to be salt. It means to be a strength. It means to be an anchor in times of trouble. The glory of God speaks of the goodness of God. It speaks of the love of God. Can you say amen? It speaks of the life of God. It speaks of the mercy of God. It speaks of the grace of God. The glory of God is really the being of God. It's really who God is. In His innermost being, God is good. We sang that song, God is so good. We can sing that all the time. Because God is a good God. Amen. And that's why the church was born. The church was born to manifest the glory of God. But something is lacking. Something is lacking in the church. If we have to go to that point where we fake a resurrection, where we fake a healing. Now listen, there are many all over the world, there are many healings, true healings taking place. But there are a lot of fake healings. Amen. That is really a man's attempt to try and make the Bible true. Let me tell you, man cannot make the Bible true because the Bible is the Word of God. God is awake over His Word to perform it. All we have to do is to preach the Word of God, and God will perform His own work. He will perform His Word. Because God is faithful to His Word. Something is lacking, like we are like Lazarus. He was resurrected. He was called out of death. 4 days in death, in the grip of death. 4 days. His body was rotting away. But the Word of life came down into that grave. Somebody said, it's a good thing Jesus only said Lazarus. He mentioned his name, otherwise all the dead would have risen. They would have come out of the grave. But there is going to be a day when all the dead will hear His voice and all the dead will come out of the grave. Praise God. Amen. All of those who have believed in Him, the resurrection and the life. We've received life. We've been resurrected. But we've got these grave clothes. And our true identity is still covered up. Like Lazarus, he was bound by those grave clothes. He was wrapped up in, can you imagine, you know, coming out there. He was wrapped up like a mummy. His face was wrapped up. His identity was covered. And beyond that, he still had the stench of death upon all those clothes, those rags. And Jesus said to them, take off those grave clothes and let him go. You see, we still have got this, but I believe it's about to change. The word of the Lord will not return void to him. There's a promise I want to read to you this morning here. Isaiah, prophet of God who prophesied, and I believe it's concerning the end times. And he said here in Isaiah, and somebody will say, yeah, that is concerning Israel. And I believe it is applicable to Israel. But it's even more applicable to the body of Christ in the end times. And he prophesied and said, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and His glory will be seen upon you. There's a day coming where the glory of God will be seen upon His people. Those grave clothes will be removed. The identity of God's children will be revealed, and there will be a shining light. Come on, the life of Christ upon His people. I believe that day is coming. That's why we're here this morning, because you believe it as well. You believe that there is a resurrection. If you didn't believe in the resurrection, you wouldn't have come this morning. But you believe. It's time to take off the grave clothes. Come on, say to somebody, it's time to take off those grave clothes. Listen, I'm bringing a word to you this morning. I'm saying to you, the Lord is saying to you. Derek, God is saying to you this morning. Brothers and sisters, friends, God is saying to His church, it is time to take off the grave clothes. It is time to unwrap yourself, to get those grave clothes. I can imagine that when Lazarus came out, he wanted to get out of those rags around him. I mean, it was stinking inside there. He wanted to get out. He was alive. He wanted to get out. Listen, a man who's alive does not like to be wrapped up in grave clothes. He does not like to be hindered by grave clothes. He wants to be alive. He wants to go out and say, I'm alive. I was dead for 4 days. My body started to rot. But a word came into me. The word of life came into me. And I'm alive. I'm not dead anymore. Come on. He wanted to go home to his family. He wanted to testify about the power of God in his life. Those grave clothes, that life of Adam. See, when you look in the mirror, this morning, we all looked into the mirror. What did we see? We saw Adam. And if you keep on looking at Adam, you'll see that Adam is decaying. Every time you go and look in the mirror, you see more gray hair. I know some of you haven't got any hair left. But you see more wrinkles. You see that death. You see, in your Adam, you carry death. Your Adam is manifesting death, sickness, even sin. That false identity, I'm sure. The first thing they did, they unwrapped his face. Because your face speaks of identity. Their face says who you are. Come on now. I'm sure they wanted to make sure the right person came out. Lazarus, is that really you? Yeah, it's really me. See, I believe something's going to come. The Holy Spirit is going to begin to unwrap the face of the church. He's going to unwrap, come on, the body of Christ. Come on, are you part of the body of Christ? You see, the body of Christ is here on earth for a purpose. The body of Christ is here on the planet to show to the world that Jesus is really alive and He rose from the dead. He conquered death. Death is the last enemy. Listen, death is not our friend. Death is the enemy. If it was not for resurrection, our faith would be in vain. Our faith would mean nothing. The cross without the resurrection can only remove our sins. Cannot really help us for the future. But it's the resurrection power of God that will raise us up in the last day. You see, that those grave clothes, they are the smell of death. Those works of the flesh. God is saying, take it off. In Romans 6 verse 4 we read, so when we were baptized, we were buried with Christ and took part in His death. And just as Christ was raised from death by the wonderful power of the Father, so we can now live a new life. We can now live a new life. We can now live a new life. Come on. Not someday in the by and by, but we can live now. Come on, say it. We can live now a new life. We can live now a new life. We can live now a new life. See, when we got saved, we received a deposit. If you are born again, or the day when you got born again, something happened. God deposited in your spirit a portion of the Holy Spirit, if I may put it this way. He deposited something of the Spirit of God inside of you. He deposited a life inside of you. But that life is going to come to its fullness. That was like a prepayment for the fullness that is going to come. Come on now. So you have already got inside of your spirit. You've already received life, resurrection life. But it's by faith. By faith we went down into the water. We got baptized. We united with Jesus in His death. And by faith we rose from the water. As a significant, we are rising from death. And by faith we step out. By faith we turn our back on Adam's. By faith we are a new creation. Come on now. By faith we walk to our future. By faith we are saying, I have life. I have eternal life. I don't belong to the grave anymore. I belong to Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now Jesus said, not only take off those grave clothes, He also said, and let Him go. Well, And this is really the purpose of the church in this time. It's time to go and manifest the resurrection life. It's time to go and demonstrate Jesus is alive. It's time to spread His fragrance wherever we go. Spread His fragrance wherever we go. Demonstrate His life wherever we go. Demonstrate His power and His strength. This is what it's all about. 2 Corinthians, let's close here. 2 Corinthians 2 verse 14 says, "But thanks be to God, who in Christ always leads us in triumphal procession and through us spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of Him everywhere." You see, once upon a time, we carried that smell of death. But now, we carry a different smell. We carry the fragrance of Christ. We carry resurrection life. Let's stand. I'm going to invite you this morning. I'm challenging you this morning. Because God has got a purpose for us. Once He has accomplished His purpose, He will call us up to the wedding feast of the Lamb. But there are many thousands, even millions of people that needs to be saved still. The gospel needs to go out to many nations still. And I'm calling you out this morning. I'm saying to you this morning, won't you just go like this? Shake yourself loose this morning. Shake yourself loose from those grave clothes. And make a declaration. Say to yourself this morning, I'm shaking the grave clothes off. I'm not going to be hindered by Adam any longer. I'm shaking it off. I'm coming out in the power of the resurrection. Come on. Why? Because I believe Jesus is alive. I believe Jesus is alive. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank You this morning for the Word. And I pray that the Word will inspire and the Word will encourage and the Word will empower. Thank You now that Your Word will not return void to You, but it will accomplish for what You have sent it to, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank You now for Your resurrection life. In this moment, we declare healing and deliverance in the body of Christ. We declare victory in the body of Christ. And we declare that the works of the devil is destroyed. Greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. We declare the victory. We declare the kingdom of Christ in South Africa. And we thank You, Lord Jesus, that You will conquer in this land. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Come on. Let's take our seats for a moment. Let's take our seats and there's going to be a...
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness, and rose at every sound. Half in hopeless sorrow, half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. Then just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window, I looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said, "They've moved Him in the night, and none of us knows where. Oh, the stone's been rolled away, and now His body isn't there." So we both ran to the garden, then John ran on ahead. and we found the stone, an empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Oh, something strange had happened there, just what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, because I'd seen them crucify him. And then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. So even if he was alive, it could never be the same. Then suddenly, the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Then Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and I just clung to him and cried. Oh, but then he raised me to my feet. And as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Oh, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.